And the next section is, can you feel the presence of God? This comes up in Christian atheist debates. People say, a lot of times a Christian will say to an atheist, well, you know what, maybe you just got to try God. You just got to try Jesus and, you know, just try it and see what you think. You'll never understand. I mean, it's not a matter of arguing you into the kingdom of God. You got to feel a personal relationship. And having a personal relationship with Jesus is like having a personal relationship with your spouse. And just as you wouldn't doubt a personal relationship with your spouse, you shouldn't doubt this personal relationship with Jesus. Well, I was a Christian. I was born again evangelical Christian. I believe I felt exactly what the Christians feel when they say they have a personal relationship with Jesus. I felt like I was led by God. I prayed for guidance. I believe that any Christian that says they are led by God or communicates with God or has a presence of God, I believe I had that. And I now consider it a delusion, the God delusion. And I want to say also, I think it's a logical fallacy that there's a fallacy called appeal to emotion, where you say, basically, your emotions cannot determine reality or what the truth of a thing. So, for example, if you have a guy on trial for being a murderer, but this guy looks really nice in a suit and he's very charismatic, you don't want to say, oh, that guy's such a nice guy, he couldn't have murdered people. The way he presents himself, your feelings, they cannot determine whether this guy is guilty or not. You have to look at the evidence. And so in the same way, you cannot have feelings for God and say this is evidence that God exists. So that's my position. I'd like to hear what your response is.
Okay. Well, yeah, that's your experience, and I'll just tell you mine. Basically, Psalm 4:4 says, to sit on your bed in silence and ponder your heart. Okay, so I did that as a formal practice, at least an hour in the morning and an hour at night for about 5 years. And what I can say is my experience with that is when you go inside, if you silence your mind, which is a very, you know, chatty creature, you start experiencing more and more an increasing peace and an increasing clarity. You know, if you're not thinking about something, you're seeing it. So, but then the more that you get into that, that increase keeps increasing. And it comes to the point where you go into states of bliss and even then ecstasy. And the greatest experiences I've had in my life have been in those states. And when you're in those states, all you're doing is just kind of, I call it internal silent observation. If you're doing it as a scientist, say, you end up seeing that there's a presence deep inside of your heart. I mean, some people call it the sixth sense. Some people call it intuition. But it's a presence. You can feel the presence. And when you're in it, you know it's God. And so, I mean, I highly recommend that to everybody, because what happens is when you're walking through life, that presence doesn't go away. So harmony with that presence leads you to the best possible life and ways to approach life.
But what do you think about what I said, where I felt that presence? I know the presence you're talking about, and I have to conclude that it's a delusion to conflate that with that God exists, because there is no evidence. There's no good evidence for the existence of God. Therefore, it has to be a delusion.
Okay.
There's people of all kinds of religions that you would say their religion is obviously wrong, and yet they say they also experience God. You know, for example, Muslim or Hindus.
Yeah, I don't say they're wrong, and neither does, like, say, the Catholic Church, for instance.
You do say they're wrong, because, for example, Muslims would not say that Jesus died on the cross for your sins, and you say they do.
Now you're getting into a mental area, though. See, that's a mental conclusion. Even your delusion conclusion is a mental conclusion. But what I'm talking about is the experiential reality, and people in other religions do experience God, do experience that reality. Now, when they take it into mental conclusions, that's where the problems happen.
But they're getting these messages from God, or these insights, these profound ideas, and they're writing them down as inspirations. I can't remember the word for it, when you epiphany. They're getting these epiphanies. They're obviously from God because they're so powerful and effective, and yet these epiphanies of different religions conflicted with each other.
Yeah, I would question if they're epiphanies or not. Because there's only one God and there's only one truth. So, you know, but the Bible says, it says that God is love. So when you're experiencing love in your heart, and anybody can experience that throughout the world, you're experiencing God. And it also says that God wishes that none should perish. So I think he's made an effort with every human being at one point in their life to reveal himself to them and the opportunity to be idealistic on his level.
Well, let me tell you something. When I was an evangelical Christian, I met with some Mormons, and they said, basically, in the Book of Mormon, it says to pray about the Book of Mormon, and that pray to God to give you a burning in the bosom, if it is true or not. And I did. I prayed with an open heart, and what happened was I did get the burning in the bosom. And this is the thought process. I was a Mormon for about 5 seconds, because this is what happened. I got the burning in the bosom. I got the feeling. I thought, oh, I guess I'm a Mormon now. And then my next thought was, Bernie, how could you be a Mormon with what you know? And it's like, and I said, yeah, you're right. Because I knew too much, because I studied the history and all that. So that's an example of getting the feeling from a prayer. It's a spiritual feeling, but it's a delusion. It's wrong. It can't be from God, because the Book of Mormon, we both agree, the Book of Mormon is fiction. Right?
I don't know. I've never studied it, but I imagine so. I've never studied it. I know that I've stayed in Salt Lake City for a while, and the people there were much more advanced in terms of morality than most of America. So I have to give them that credit. But I don't know. You're entering into like a mental way of evaluating things. And so I'm saying,
I know, but see, if I just followed my heart, I would have been a Mormon. I would have said, it doesn't make sense to me, but I have to follow my heart. And then I would try to convert you to Mormonism. And what would you say to me? I'd say, look, Brother Dennis, I got the feelings. You can't argue with that, right?
Yeah, but you, when you say try to convert me, that means you're going through an intellectual thing of presenting facts to me that are either convincing or not, et cetera, et cetera.
No, I would probably ask you to do what I did and pray about the Book of Mormon and see if God reveals it to you.
Yeah, well, I did read part of the Book of Mormon, by the way, and it just looked like, you know, just a bunch of gibberish, you know, meaningless stuff. See, here's my thing as far as religion goes. My whole thing is to have a direct relationship with God. And he revealed himself literally in the Bible, but he's also experientially in our heart. And that's as far as I take it. I mean, I don't promote any religion or any kind of rules that people make up. If it's in the Bible, great. If it's not, you know, then I
okay. So you're saying that you can use your feelings that you have the presence of God. You can use that as evidence to know that God exists. And I'm saying that's a logical fallacy. You cannot determine if things exist by your feelings. And so
I agree.
We just have a disagreement there. Is that right?
No, I agree with you. But I'm saying that you take it further. And then you delve in. I mean, I delved into the Bible. I mean, part of my testimony is I tried 20 approaches to lifestyle and truth before coming to the Bible. None of them worked as far as giving me peace and clarity and deep fulfillment. Mm-hmm. When I hit the Bible, that worked. And that's been going on for 33 years now. And, you know, I've scrutinized it, you know, from an engineer's training, you know, intellectually. But also, you know, the Bible says in 1 John 2:27, it says that you've been gifted with the Holy Spirit, and that will lead you into all truth. You're not in need of a teacher. So that worked for me, and it's worked for 33 years.
Okay, so let's leave it there since we're out of time on this segment, and go to the next one.